guys, welcome back to another video. This is Motivation for Young Christians. Welcome back. Welcome back to another episode of Bible Study. This is Bible Study episode 51. Today we're diving into John chapter 21, verse 15 through 25. Today we have Brother Gio and also we have Brother Nate in the building to discuss the word with us. And today is the last episode that we're going to be going into John. After this, we're going to move right into the next book of the Bible. And thank you guys so much for coming along in this journey with us through John. We begin this journey in John with Brother Gio, and we're going to end it off with Brother Gio. So shout out to him for coming together and us for doing this for almost a year. The 30th of this month will make a year of the first Bible study. So we've been going strong. We're going to continue to go strong. So thank you guys so much for always tuning in. To begin, we're going to start off with a prayer by Brother Gio. We're going to be led by me today, and we're going to end off with a prayer by me. So if you guys can, please bow your heads.
Father, we thank you. Father, we love you. Father, we worship you and we honor you. It is your will that we seek you with all our hearts. It is your will that we will desire to have more of you. So as we come before you in the name of Jesus, to sit at your feet by way of reading your word, I pray that you would reveal yourself unto us, that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you would give us understanding, wisdom, and knowledge of this passage that would edify us and that would glorify you. Let it be transforming. Let it be changing. Let it pierce our hearts and do whatever it needs to do so that we can look more like you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Now I'll be diving into the word for today. Verse 15 says, after breakfast, Jesus asked Simon Peter, Simon, son of God, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, Peter replied. You know I love you. Then feed my lamb, Jesus told him. Verse 16, Jesus repeated the question, Simon, the son of God, son of John, do you love me? Yes, Lord, Peter said. You know I love you. Then take care of my sheep, Jesus says. Verse 17, a third time he asked him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt that Jesus asked the question a third time. He said, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Jesus said, then feed my sheep. Verse 18, I tell you the truth. When you were young, you were able to do as you like. You dressed yourself and went wherever you wanted to go. But when you're old, you will stretch out your hands, and others will dress you and take you where you don't want to go. Verse 19, Jesus said, this to let him know by what kind of death he would glorify God. Then Jesus told him, follow me. Peter turned around and saw behind them the disciple Jesus loved, the one who had leaned over to Jesus during supper and asked, Lord, who will betray you? Verse 21. Peter asked Jesus, what about him, Lord? Jesus replied, if I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you? As for you, follow me. Verses 23. So the rumor spread around among the community of believers that this disciple wouldn't die. But that isn't what Jesus said at all. He only said, if I wanted him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you? Verses 24. This disciple is the one who testified to these events and has recorded them here. And we know that his account of these things are accurate. Last verse, verse 25. Jesus also did many other things. If they were all written down, I suppose the whole world could not contain the books that would have been written. This was the final reading for today, chapter 21, verses 15 to 25. Now we'll be getting into our thoughts of the scripture. I have a question for verses 16, and my question is, Jesus is saying, if you love me, then preach to my people and spread the word to God. Because I was kind of confused by the part where Jesus was telling John, if you love me, then take care of my sheep. So I'm thinking, is he using the word sheep as in like people? If you love me, then take care of my people, spread the word to my people, be with my people, and just kind of in that sense, verses 16.
Absolutely. He's telling him to nurture after the people that he has placed under his, I guess, jurisdiction, so to speak. Like, feed the people, give them the word that they need to survive in this world. I was actually looking at the footnotes in the Bible I have, and it was even comparing Peter to like people like pastors and missionaries, teachers and parents. They are all the term under shepherd, or I guess as we learn in church, like stewards. God gives us things to be stewards over, almost like a keeper, to do right by these things, to feed these things, to nurture after these things. And in this case, he's talking about the people.
Something was interesting to me that stood out, though. I mean, my pastor talk about it often. Gio, as you said that, the first time he says it, there's a, in New King James Version and the ESV, I noticed that the first time he asked them that, and he said, yes, Lord, you know I love you. At the end of verse 15, he said, feed my lamb. The other two times it says, feed my sheep. King James, New King James, ESV. I kind of peeped that, and I was like, what'd that mean? And I almost, you correct me if I'm wrong, but in my studies of scriptures, I found out that the lambs or lamb in most cases is always about Christ. And before you go out to feed the sheep, you're saying, it's almost like saying, minister to me. Love me, for, you know, love on me.
That's exactly what. So
that part always blew my mind. When my pastor broke that down for me, I was like, I didn't really realize that a lot of times before I heard him preach about it, the young kid I would hear just to feed my sheep, because it's all about restoring Peter. But the restoration wouldn't have started if he didn't learn to feed the lamb, minister unto God first, minister unto the Lamb of God, Jesus the Christ.
That's exactly. So I was going to say to Ezron, if he noticed that was going to be my next question, because I think that he like you said, he transitions from lamb to sheep, right? Like you said, first it's unto God, and then it's unto the people, and when he talks about, do you love me? It also looks like there's a different type of love that he's talking about. In the Greek, you have the agape or agape. Mm-hmm. Right? And then you have filio. Mm-hmm. The agape love is like the unconditional, the deep, the divine love. And I think that's the one he's referring to when he talks about feed my lambs, minister unto me. But then the filial love, like the brotherly love, I think that's when he's talking about feed my sheep, the people. Mm. And I think he's saying, now this I might be reaching, right? But I think he's saying, your love for the people and you having the, I guess, the job to feed them should not be predicated on your feelings, but should be focused on
the devotion you have for me, yeah.
Your commitment.
That's interesting, man. I like another study says that, you know, you can also look at the lambs as like the young. You've got to care for them from young in maturity to the old as well. Sheep, which transitions to a mature version of the lamb. because every sheep starts out as a lamb. But it's just so crazy that you can, when you can read and dive into things, you can get, you can really dive in. But I, that part right there, he said to love me. I also believe that it wasn't just because a lot of us don't talk about like how real agape love is. The agape love is more thoughtful and purposeful, involving loving the entire person, the personality. It's a decision of the mind and will. So it's almost asking him, what's your decision? Because you got to remember, he had the zeal for Christ, but the commitment wasn't there because he denied him.
Yeah, and I think that's why he kind of breaks down after the third time, because then he, I think, back to his memory, like you know I love you, number one. Number two, you know I love you. And then the third time, you got me again.
You know, yeah, he's like, you know, yeah.
You got me again. Like, I remember saying that, you know, I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. Oh, okay. You're going to deny me before the croc crows. You know what I mean? And then I was just like, eh. And that agape love, man, the way you just put it, like, it's purposeful and it's a decision. Like, it's intentional. Mm-hmm. To the whole character, everything about, I almost wonder if that's even attainable. Like, can you reach to that point to love someone with the agape love that Christ showed towards us as a human?
Yes. Yes, we can. It's being perfected, though, because I feel like some people sometimes downplay the power of agape love. You work on it every day when you love your wife, because some days it's not, you don't have the filial, you don't get that spontaneous feeling. You know, it's a decision.
Gio, don't do that. Don't, Gio, you know this is going on YouTube.
Every married couple, no matter don't do how that. Been in it. I know y'all celebrated your anniversary recently. No matter how deep you love her, how good she looked, how good she cooked, how good to, you know what I'm saying? Some days it's the decision to press through, and that's agape being worked out in context. Love is a decision. I didn't start the fire, but I'm just saying, you know, every husband and every wife, if they put them on truth serum, no matter how long, I'm telling you, if you live long enough, or if you don't come back, I'm like, you live long enough to get married, okay, I'm going to tell you right now, there's going to be some days where it's a decision. And I've seen the best of couples when they go through it, man. That agape gets worked out in that context. That's why, if you read further on the scriptures, you see love likened unto marriage, especially in the book of Ephesians. Yeah. But I also believe that if he didn't have that spontaneous, that filial love as well, that passion as well, not just the decision, but also the passion now working hand in hand, because prior to this, I always believe that Peter had the passion, but it just wasn't in his, it wasn't lodged in there just yet. He had the passion. All the disciples had a passion, but it's just, it wasn't lodged in there. It wasn't a decision yet. It wasn't when love became a decision. That's when love is matured and matures. When you go beyond the feelings, the infatuation, a lot of people's relationships don't make it because they never mature to that phase of agape, where it's a willful, intentional decision. So it's not a bad thing. I didn't mean to put you on the spot in that example, but a lot of people say, yo, I'm ever going to get there. And I talked to somebody two weeks ago, I was like, yeah. If you learn how to decide to love somebody through crises, and you both are willing to do it, you're working on agape love. Agape love to a degree is being worked out in the both of you. And especially if you learn to love from God's view, it's not impossible. So, yeah. It's a journey. That's a whole nother...
That's not the Bible study.
What's got to do with it?
That's the difference.
Let the church say amen.
Yo, like, so it's crazy, man. Like, I think you might be on something, Nate. Like, I think you might have hit the nail on the head, because it when you say decision, like, and if you like, I think there's always etymology or epistemology. Like, when you study the words and you break it down, like, the whole decision, like die incision, like to scission, to like cut off something else. Like you're cutting off in your mind the thought to do away with this person. Mm-hmm. And then you're saying like, my mind is made up. I'm going to love this person with all that is within me in spite of everything else. Because I love this person, everything about them for who they are. And that's what it took. That's like the love of Christ. And like you said, it's a mm-hmm. journey. Mm-hmm. One-stop shop. Like you're traveling through this journey of agape love. So I think the way this chapter closes with the conversation between Peter and Christ is essential to what is getting ready to happen to Peter as we move on to Acts. You know, he's like, he's almost like leaving him with this portion, like you said, minister unto me that you may be able to minister unto my people.
And I wanted to hit on that note, minister unto him before you minister unto others. It's training, because in that process of training to guide with God and Jesus, you can make your mistakes and you're learning, because you got to make sure you be prepared, because God people is tough. He know how his people operate, so that's why you're being trained by the man himself. So that way, when you go out there, you're going out there prepared. And I've been trained by the man himself. That's why I'm so good at what I do right now. But I didn't look at it verses 15. I did not look at it in that perspective. Minister unto me before you minister unto others. I did not look at it in that perspective. But that's a very key point. I'll make sure I wrote that down.
Especially because it says lamb. If you notice, it says lamb. But then there's the plural. When I look at it from the New King James, I think it's so dope to check out other versions. You know. Because you get it actually, it's like, wait a minute, but if you're saying this, how are you saying that? I have four verses I primarily study from, but when I saw the feed my lambs, I just said, man, this speaks to the tender that also as well. Like when you hear lamb in the New Testament, it always refers to the Lamb of God, but then when he said lambs, not little hymns, but then you think about it, like, wait a minute, there are little hymns, people that just come to faith. They matter just as much as the sheep. Because in a lot of church circles, the lambs aren't considered, sorry, that's another conversation. The lambs aren't considered as valuable to the process as developing the sheep. And then the lambs grow up distorted. I'll leave that alone. But yeah, but you have to be as devoted to the whole process as well. So I like your take on that as well. Like, you know, you got ministering unto others. That means everybody at every walk, at every stage. This is the basic qualification on two levels, Christian service, but also for like even the pastor, because the pastor is considered a shepherd if you translate that into Greek. You'll get into that another time when you talk about, quote unquote, when you talk about the fivefold ministries in Ephesians. That's what pastor really means, not in the way that we see it, the primary preacher, but actually the shepherd, actually someone that's caring about the emotional and maturing spiritual maturity of the believer. We're usually trained. This is why this conversation matters, because we're usually trained to know pastor or the pastorate in the way that we know how to do church. But one of the key things about the pastorate, for example, because I've heard somebody encourage a pastor with this, he said, you're the one that's going to feed and do the dirty work of making sure that they're clean, making sure that if you study the shepherd's life, it's not all the way fun, because you've always got to redirect sheep sometimes because they want to go their own way sometimes, and you've got to train them to know your voice. So there's a lot to it.
Definitely. That's a tough one.
Sidebar, your timing is perfect. I was going to say, because next weekend is like the weekend before Pentecost. So, I mean, going into the book of Acts, if that's where you're going next, you're doing a good thing. Sidebar.
Funny thing is, I never think of that. And the thing that just like right around Easter when we had the video we was talking about the significance of Easter, I never even timed that. I was just going along based on the scripture, and then I realized that okay, Easter is literally in 2 days, or like when that was a Saturday, so Easter was one day. Yeah. So I didn't. It's God, because I don't be paying attention like that. But going into verses 17, I wrote the note of that as a follower of Christ, you're responsible to take care of the world and what God has given to you.
Not bad. That's a good insight, man. That's good. And what Gio said, too, about the third time, it's true. When he said, that conversation, it all came back. Some would say, I think it's just that the depth of it is almost like altar call, or what an altar call should be. That's like, you really love him, make a commitment, make a decision. Like, so that's a good insight that you put on there. That's a good insight too.
So I think I actually have a question, because I didn't get a chance to do my homework. Forgive me, Ezron. I guess transitioning from 18, 19, and then from 20 to 25, the topic kind of changes. He talks about when you're young, you're able to do this, but then when you're older, you're able to do that. And then it says in 20, he talks about Peter turning about to see the disciple who Jesus loved following, which also leaned on his breast at supper. And said, Lord, which is he that betrayeth thee? I want to dig into these couple of chapters before I got to head out. I mean, these couple of verses before I have to head out, and just kind of really dig and figure out what's happening. Did you have any questions for those verses, Ezra?
Yes. Especially, I believe, was that 18? Yeah, with the 18. Because my insight on 18, I was thinking of the sense of, before you dedicate your life to Christ, you had the ability, do what you want to do, go where you want to do. I mean, go where you want to go. But then once you choose Christ, it's like now the decisions are kind of being made for you. God is going to tell you where to go, where to go. where to go, what to do. Kind of like how it says when you're old, your hand will be stretched out and others will dress you. God will fit us up to be able to go out. So that was my insight in verses 18.
You add anything, Gio? Because something did jump out at me.
Yeah, so I'm just really trying to like wrap my mind around it. I'm asking the Holy Spirit to give me revelation. Because even in verse 18, he's having this conversation. And he's like, I say unto you, when you were young, you gather your things and you moved about as you would. But then as you get older, you have to stretch forth your hands. Someone will carry you where you don't want to go. He says, this, I'm telling you this, signifying by what death he should glorify God. And when he said this,
I had a question about that too. Because I think for, that was verse 19. I wrote down.
Okay.
Yeah. I wrote down what kind of debt he would glorify God. And I said, when God was little, did he dress himself? But after people died, they dressed him? I was thinking in that sense, because when you die, people dress you.
That, okay.
I was kind of confusing that. So I was just trying to get some type of thing for that to make sense.
In simple language, it was more so the journey of life in general, but also he's also talking about the journey of his walk with Jesus Christ. And when he said, when you're old, you're going to be, people are going to carry where you don't want to go. Your hands to be bound. He was really talking about execution. He was telling Peter the way his life was going to go. Some people believe this was letting him know that very early, like, listen, you're going to suffer crucifixion as well. Because in crucifixion, you're being led to, if you remember, Jesus's way to the cross. You can go back to his prayer at Gethsemane, where he really didn't want to go. So he's telling Peter, you're going to experience the same kind of feeling, almost literally. Because if you look at Peter's life at the end, he does die by crucifixion. The story has it that Peter went about being crucified. He actually asked, don't crucify me in the same position of my Lord and Savior. Crucify me upside down. And that's a more terrible way to die, because all the blood is rushing upward to your head and boom, blood pressure take you out. So it was really telling them, listen, if you want to take it for even today's context for yourself, being crucified to yourself is the best way to glorify God. But in this original text, he's telling Peter, this is what's going to happen.
Yeah, that's daily crucifixion, I guess making a daily decision to crucify self, crucify your flesh. That's
if you could take it for you, something that you can take for yourself.
Yeah.
Because if you go through Colossians of being crucified with Christ, that's what glorifies him. But right. In a literal conversation with Peter, you can see that he's really telling him, this spake he, verse 19, signifying what death he should glorify God. You know, it was the prediction that would follow his restoration, basically. And he's saying, basically, you're going to do what I did, feeding the lambs, feeding the sheep. But after a long career of doing it, you'll be counted worthy to die in my name. Because when he died in that persecution period, how each disciple had passed, except for John. John's the only one that died a natural cause. Everybody else died violently, even to Apostle Paul, who wasn't a part of the original. So yeah, this literally speaks of the path that he's going to take. You're young now, and you're going to serve. But when your time comes, you're going to be led in the same way I was led to be crucified. But Peter made a decision. So it goes back to decision again. Because of his love for the Lord, he didn't see himself worthy of being crucified right side up. He said, crucify me another direction. I love him, but I'm not worthy to be just in the same. He said that just because he wasn't worthy to die in the same literal manner like Jesus did. So you see it come. If you follow Peter's life, you see that conversation follows full circle. That makes sense.
Yeah, that really do make sense, because I didn't do my background studying on what eventually happened to them. So now it makes sense. If I probably would have done the background study, that scripture would have made more sense to me. But now it makes sense. And going back to the point of it's a daily crucifixion to self, because our flesh, we're born into sin and shaped in iniquity. So our flesh is sinful. But it's a daily crucifixion to do right. It's a daily crucifixion to abide by God, abide by the Lord, abide by his teaching, his calling, his word, his movement. It's a daily crucifixion. Also, again, back to the point of the marriage. It's like a daily crucifixion because you have to, like, kind of, like, sacrifice yourself. If you kind of, like, get what I'm saying, Gio, since you're the married one here. Did that make sense?
Yes, brother. You have no.
Okay, good.
But one day you will, God willing. Daily. You know what? I want to bring it, scale it down, moment by moment sacrifice. But I think, yes, it's work. Like any relationship, like even your friendship, you know, it takes work. It's an intentional work, but I think the reward outweighs the what appears to be the burden of the work that it involves. But it's definitely a decision. And it takes a certain level of maturity to make that sound decision like that. So I appreciate your words, Nate, on this one. This definitely is something that I'm going to have to use definitely in today as well. Like I'm going to have to die to self today. and move on past some things. And then on that note, I actually have to move on from this session and get to my class that I'm late for. So, gentlemen, it's been real. I'll see you on the next
one. I don't want to skip 20 and 21, but I have a question for 22. Mm-hmm. So we could probably just go back to 20 and 21. But my question for 22 is, what does Jesus mean? Because it says, Jesus replied, "If I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you? As for you, follow me."
Verse 12. Okay. I think it was also calling his focus, because if you go about this conversation, this time of interacting with the disciples, one of the things that I picked up on was that he is really speaking to everybody about the way they should go, but he was asking about John. What about him? What will he do? You know, what is of his destiny? What is his fate? How shall I fare in comparison to him? And Jesus basically is shutting that down. And is like, listen, you don't worry about that. Because historically, John was the one of the 12 that survived the destruction of Jerusalem, you know, and the commencement of the series that belonged to, quote unquote, the last days of Jerusalem. But it's basically saying, listen, you don't worry about that. You follow me. You focus on that, you know. It's basically saying, listen, if he will tarry till I come, or what have you, that's not unto you, you know. And I think he's also just, I guess, closing any door that, you know, that the even his coming was closer, his second return would be closer in those days, which is another conversation, eschatology, because there's different views, different perspectives. But I know he literally was just sharing with his disciples in the room, like, you focus on following me. If John, because he asked about John specifically, John remains, or if John is the sole survivor of what's to come, you don't worry about that. You follow me. You commit yourself to following me. That's pretty much what it is.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much for that revelation. Going back to verses 20. Is he talking about Jesus? Because he mentioned that the one who leaned over to Jesus during supper and asked, "Lord, who will betray you?" And Jesus did ask that question, even though he knew he was going to betray God.
I think it's, oh, you know what it was? It just came back to me. Because there were certain things in that Last Supper that Jesus described that the one who would betray him would do. Like being close to him, dipping his finger in and at the same time with him as the bread. So he was alluding to that. I think he might have still been just kind of wrestling with that. I was like, wait a minute, is John going to betray you too? And it's like, no, it's not even like that. And that's when he asked, what's going to become of him? Because little did they know, all the way back in John chapter 13, that Judas was going to do what he did in contribution to the story of Jesus Christ being crucified. And then Judas's own fate. Because Judas, I think we mentioned it, Judas could have been restored if he really wanted to. But as he prayed, the son of perdition, the fate was a part of the story, unfortunately. You know, but he could have been restored. He could have wrestled with the grief like how Peter did, because Peter had wrestled with the grief of denying Jesus. And denying Jesus, his relationship with Jesus, some would say was more grievous than accidentally selling him to religious leaders. You know, so he's alluding to that because they were in supper. The scene looked the same, if you want to say. For the little bit of diving in I did into that, the scene looked the same, if that makes sense.
It does. And we already covered verses 23 as before. So we could go straight into 24 and 25. Is in verse 24, the verse talking about Peter Are they talking about Peter? Because this
no, is... John.
Oh, they're talking about John.
John's epilogue. Yeah, okay. Basically, this is a disciple who testifies to these things and who wrote them down. We know that his testimony is true. And there are many other things what Jesus did. If they were written one by one, I suppose not even the world itself could contain the books that would be written. Some would say that, man, this epilogue was so powerful because of the simple fact that you don't get every detail of the ministry that he did. But you're just letting the reader know that, you know, it was the ministry of Jesus running over, and many gospels could have been written. Think about this. He had 12. Each of the 12 had an experience or perspective. You really only hear four. That makes the canon or the scriptures.
True. Because each 12 could have either wrote their own book or their own entire Bible. And then you got, because you have 13 different perspectives. You got the 12 disciple perspective, and then you got Jesus' perspective. So that's that alone, Jesus alone could be a good like 3 to 4 books.
Well, his life was enough of the scriptures for us, because the scriptures are talking about him anyhow. So if you're looking at the 12, yeah, the Bible, every book from Genesis to Revelation is really pointing to Christ. So if every disciple, you know, and it's crazy because I don't think some people would have honored the disciples or because of us disciples, apostles, the disciples, they didn't get that. Every disciple could have owned, but they didn't. And I think it's also divine wisdom because he said not even the world itself could contain the books that would be written. Because from one person's gospel's perspective, there could have been such a burst. And you get into it later on that the scriptures, the power of scriptures, it was breathed on by God, inspired by men. These men were the ones chosen that the book was written about. Because, I mean, the Bible doesn't say it, but maybe they did write some stuff. Maybe they did chronicle some things for themselves. You know? So.
Maybe they did.
Some said that this is like more so folklore. I haven't really dove into it, but they were talking about even some of the miracles Jesus was doing from his teenage years to when he came out into ministry, little miracles, little creative things he did. There's little things about that and stuff like that, but that's not in the Bible itself. And I think it just goes to verify what John is saying. Like, if you really go through everything Jesus did one by one, there's no room for the book of Acts. There's no room because he did so much. Even post-resurrection, how he miraculously appears to them, even though he's in flesh. How did he do that? You don't really hear as much miracles and stuff like that post-resurrection than pre. A lot of reasons for that. But I think it's supposed to point to the miracle, the main miracle that he got up. No matter what he did after, the main miracle is that he said he'd come back to life, and he did. And then the Bible talks about further on in 1 Corinthians, he's the first fruit of them that slept. Because did Jesus ever die again? No. Lazarus, think about it. Lazarus was resurrected. Lazarus died again. But Jesus got up and he didn't die again. So that's the book of John. That epilogue is really simple, but to me it's really powerful. Luke's is pretty powerful too, if you ever take the chance to look at it, you know. And
definitely gotta dive into Luke. Myself, I definitely have to dive into it. I've read a couple of scriptures in there, but not go into it as a whole. But I would definitely do my weeks to get into Luke as a whole. And it's just powerful. And with the last scripture, I also compared to just a person's life. Like, nobody's life could just be captured into one movie because there's so many things that occur, so many things that you just can't use one movie or like an hour and a half to tell somebody's life story. Like, just in case I do a life story, some type of biopic or documentary of me, It's going to have to be a couple parts because an hour won't be able, because just these 70 years can't be covered in an hour. It can't. Them 70 years can't be covered in an hour.
You only cover like the main highlights of both, but nobody's life is just an hour movie. Yeah. Or can be contained in one book. John is right. And if you even look at it from that perspective, that's a very good perspective to look at. But here's the thing. Who got to tell him his life? 12 different people. You get four books, but those men, if you include in the book of Acts, Matthias, the one that replaced Judas, you know? And then you have Mary. You have the Marys. You have Paul, who encountered Christ. You have us, who received Jesus Christ in our heart. So his story's not ever really ended. You see what I'm saying? So you still hear about the story of Christ. His name is still the most controversial, but the most popular, or is gaining popularity, or you're hearing his name a lot more than you hear, you know, might have said you heard before. But it makes sense. You can't contain it all in one book. You have four perspectives, which is a great perspective, which is the Gospels. John gives the best, a lot of people say John gives the best perspective because you got to see both sides. But that's just opinion. I think all four gives great perspective, different angles, even if they had the common miracles, because all four books talk about the feeding of the 5,000. All four books talks about his crucifixion and his resurrection, just from different angles. So take that with you. That's the gospel. One message, or the book of the gospels, is just the same message, one message, four different angles. You'll see some more of it in the book of Acts, to be honest, because how Paul encounters the Lord, or Saul, which eventually became Paul, how his encounter was, it was very much different. But he encountered Jesus Christ nonetheless. So
very true. And also being the comparison that of you talking about how one message was turned into four. Same thing as now, just as us as preacher, we could all use the same topic and we could do it in a whole bunch of different ways, because it's all on perspective. It's all on your thoughts, your opinion, what God brings to your head, because it's never one way. Your revelation, never one way. It's never one way to preach about sorrow. It's never one way to preach about forgiveness. It's a whole bunch of different way. I got my way to preach forgiveness, brother. They got his way, brother. Jill got his way, brother. Javi got his way. There's so many ways to preach, because all in our revelation and our perspective. Any more thoughts? Any more opinion in scripture, brother Nate?
No, I just think that overall, it's a beautiful thing to know, and it's a beautiful thing to go through the book. You so far you've done so well with remaining consistent. When you're studying the scriptures, consistency is so key. So even putting it out there, I think that's so dope. Commend you again. But especially with the season and the time that we're in, good, great study, great looking at the scriptures, because he prepares them for what's ahead. This last chapter, he's preparing them for what's ahead. Chapter before, I think he talked about he breathed on them and they received the Spirit. He prepared them for what was ahead. They were first partakers before Pentecost happened, you know? So there's so much in there, and down to the conversation. So it's all about, it all points back to Jesus. Everything he did, he demonstrated. And the main takeaway is the depth of our devotion to him is going to matter in feeding the sheep and changing the world. If we don't fully love him, we're not going to do it right. Because it ties back to what he talks about, I'm the good shepherd. We only learn to be good shepherds of people's lives from the good shepherd. And we see the restoration of Peter threefold. And you see him really giving their disciples, each disciple, their journey that they're going to take. And they have to focus on following Jesus. All of us don't know our way up or our way through or way out, but we're just commanded to. Just like how he told Peter, you don't worry about John's fate or anybody else's. You follow me. We have to make the decision still to follow Jesus, come what may. So, yeah, I think that was really solid. That's all my thoughts. Did you have any more?
Yes. I just want to reiterate the thought mentioned before. It's a daily crucifixion to self.
Mm-hmm.
Not only you're following the wisdom of God and everything that Brother Nate mentioned, but you also got to make sure you are your end. It's a daily crucifixion to self, because we're born into sin and shape in iniquity, meaning that we're prone to sin. Our flesh is prone to sin. It's a daily crucifixion for us to go on this path, to sacrifice certain things we want to do to be able to follow the Heavenly Father. And I always look at it as it benefits us. Like, you giving up certain thing will benefit you. You may not think it benefit you in that moment or that situation, but it will benefit you. A lot of things that I've given up doing and stopped doing, it all benefit me. All benefit me. So you always got to think about that. And also, Jesus and God always have our best interests. Always. Always. Men, you always have to question a man's best interest, but you never have to question God's best interest, because you know that He's gonna be for you. So that's my revelation for today. But thank you so much for coming along on this episode, Brother Nate. We'll be heading to our closing prayer, which will be done by Brother Nate.
Okay, no problem. Father, thank you for the journey that you've taken us on in your holy scriptures. Thank you for Gio, Ezra, and myself who gathered here today to really talk about the closing parts and the closing components of this great book, the book of John. You inspired him. You chose him. What a powerful honor. Just like you chose us, it's a powerful honor to continue this story, Lord God, now into eternity. Father, you've chosen us. You saved us. You redeemed us for this reason, Father God. So your story continues, Father. We're your heritage spiritually. Father, we thank you for redeeming our lives. And I pray today for those that are listening that may not have made a decision to follow, or Father, they might have heard the same questions as Peter. You love me, Father. For those that are listening, I pray that they'll respond to your heart and your call to them, Lord, to a life of devotion, a life of love and following you, Lord Jesus. I pray that those that will listen, both now and in the times to come, that they will be committed to following you, Lord Jesus, and not feel the guilt or the shame of their past. Maybe that's what was going through Peter's mind when you asked him. We don't know, but we know that he responded with his life in devotion to loving you after you restored him. And Father, after you restored them, let our lives respond to that question of our love for you. No matter if we slip up or mess up, we know that our love for you is intact. We've decided to follow you. We decide to love you. Give us the grace in these days, weeks, months to come to really grow in following you and advancing your kingdom and continuing to spread the story of your love and redemption for mankind. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen. Thank you so much for that prayer. But then this is the end of the video. So far, we have went through the whole of John. We've closed up John, as I mentioned earlier in the video. We're moving right into the next book, Acts, the next following week. And at the end of this month, the 30th, we'll make the one-year anniversary of our first Bible study. So we're going into the 1 year of doing Bible study. And I'm so happy that on this episode that Brother Gio, who I started the first Bible study with when we got into John, he was able to be here for the last time we get into John. And hopefully next week, depending on how his schedule works, he's there for when we get into Acts. But I just like to thank God as of now for the journey, for us to be able to just start this Bible study. Not only for me to educate myself and be educated by my peers, by my leaders, my elders, but for everybody else to be educated. So I want to just give a huge thank to the Heavenly Father for just instilling this in me, instilling it in y'all, and just everybody that came along through all 51 or 52, I believe, 51 or 52 episodes of Bible study. I don't know as of now. I've done too many Bible studies. But thank you so much to the Lord. If you guys haven't already, please like, subscribe. If you're new, please turn on your post notification. That way, anytime I upload, YouTube will send a notification. We'll see you guys next week in another episode of Bible study. We'll be heading into Acts. I love you guys so much. We'll see you next week. Bye.